because obviously we can't meet as a congregation, separate stations from the cross, I've been around and I've meditated on them myself, so I'm going to share you some of my thoughts as we go to each station. I spent an hour or so just contemplating the many things that happened to our Lord on this journey. As I say, I will share them with you as we go around. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O Jesus Christ, my Lord, with what great love you passed over the painful road which led you to death, and I, how often have I abandoned you. But now I love you with my whole soul, and because I love you, I am sincerely sorry for having offended you. My Jesus, pardon me, and permit me to accompany you in this journey. You are going to die for love of me, and it is my wish also, my dearest Redeemer, to die for love of you. My Jesus, in your love I wish to live, in your love I wish to die. I love thee, Jesus, my lover of all things. I repent in my whole heart of having offended thee. Never permit me to separate myself from thee again. Grant that I may love you always, and then do with me what you wilt. Oh, thou sad and sore distress, was that mother I heedless of the so begotten one? cross, there are three forms of Christ. Of course, weakened by loss of blood and stumbling along the roughly paved street, he would have fallen many times. But three is one of the biblical numbers, like 7, 12, or 40, which usually denote perfection. So you could say it's a roundabout way of saying that in death, as in life, Jesus did everything to perfection. As we make our way along with him, we will see his strength slowly ebbing away. Here, it's a simple fall, just on one knee, a stumble if you like. Not too much for the soldiers to worry about. I love thee, Jesus, my lover of all things. I repent with my whole heart of having offended thee. Never permit me to separate myself from thee again. Grant that I may love you always, and then do thee what you will. Christ above in torment hangs, she beneath beholds the pangs of her dying glorious Son. The fourth station, Jesus meets his afflicted mother. We adore thee, O Christ, and we praise thee, because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world. When I pray in stations with children, I ask them what afflicted means. They'll say upset or worried. Then I ask if any of them have ever been seriously ill. There's usually one or two who have. And we're able to explore how the mum and dad felt when they were so ill, helpless at their bedside, and unable to do anything but pray. Sadly, over the years, we've also known children who have died, and that's much, much worse. Can there be anything worse for a parent, especially as an only child? So the word we usually come up with for afflicted is devastated. Mary was a parent. In Mel Gibson's film, The Passion of Christ, as he stumbles under the weight of the cross, Mary has a flashback to Jesus as a child, falling and raising his knees. She remembers rushing to scoop him up in her arms and comfort him. Now she can do nothing. Only me there for him. A loving, heartbroken presence in the midst of a howling mob bent on making him suffer as much as possible. I love thee, Jesus, my lover of all things. I repent with my whole heart of having offended thee. Never permit me to separate myself from thee again. Grant that I may love you always, and then do with me what you will. Is there one who would not be well in misery so deep? Christ, dear mother, help my Simon of Cyrene. We adore thee, O Christ, and praise thee, because by thy holy cross thou hast redeemed the world. Now the soldiers are starting to get worried. They have a job to do, a job they're very good at, and it looks like this prisoner is not going to make it on his own. Simon, a complete stranger, up to Jerusalem for the Passover feast, a family man with two young boys, Rufus and Alexander, had come all the way from North Africa. Perhaps he was a country bumpkin, curious to see what all the fuss was about. Others must have laughed at him for drawing a short straw as the soldiers grabbed him and forced him to help carry the cross. Years later, in St. Paul's letter to the Romans, we read of a church leader called Rufus, who most commentators think was Simon's son. Could it be then that Simon, who had willingly shouldered the cross with Jesus, went on to become a Christian, to live out what Jesus said about discipleship? If anyone wants to be a follower of mine, he must take up his cross every day and follow me. The name Simon has become synonymous with anyone who lends a hand to those struggling under any great weight. I love thee, Jesus, my love above all things. I repent with my whole heart of having offended thee. Never permit me to separate myself from thee again. Grant that I love you always, and then do with me what you will. I love thee, Jesus, my love above all things. I repent with my whole heart of having offended thee. Never permit me to separate myself from thee again. Grant that I may love thee always, and then do with me what you will. For the sins of his own nation, saw him hang in desolation, till his spirit forth he sent. like if he was their son, and if they were compelled to watch him suffering on such a scale beyond reckoning. Jesus is aware of their kindness and good intentions, and in spite of the terror which is to come next for him, he says he feels sorry for them. How come? You notice that one of the women is carrying a very small child. Jesus, in his divinity, knows that when that child and its generation have grown up, settled down, and have children of their own, a catastrophe will engulf them, and they too will suffer unimaginable horror. He is referring to the destruction of Jerusalem, their home and families, with many cruel deaths to follow. This did indeed take place, as he had predicted, in the year AD 70. The temple, heartbeat of their religion, the centre of the Old Testament covenant, was destroyed, never to rise again. I love thee, Jesus, my Lord of all things. I repent my whole heart of having offended thee. Never permit me to separate myself from thee again. Grant that I may love you always, and then do in me what you will.
Grant that I may love you always, and then do with me what you will.
To drive a nail into a piece of wood is an everyday event. It's a good thing to do if you want to make sure something can hold together or stay firm. The Romans did this to human beings to make sure they did not flop or fall from the cross, as they might have done if they just used ropes, since the victims squirmed and twisted and turned to seek relief by a change of position. The idea was to keep them alive as long as possible, to literally prolong the agony. A simple sword thrust and it would all have been over, but no. The victim would hang with his whole body weight pulling on the nails, which held him fast. The normal way for a crucified man to die, if he survived for any length of time, was for the soldiers to break his legs, which then could not support him anymore, so that his body would sag, leaving him unable to breathe. I love thee, Jesus, my Lord of all things. I repent with my whole heart of having offended thee. Never permit me to separate myself from thee again. Grant that I may love you always, and then do in me what you will. Let me share with thee this pain, who for all my sins was slain, who for me in torments died. 12th station, Jesus dies on the cross. We adore you, Christ, and praise thee, because by your holy cross you have crucifixion is one of the cruelest ways man's ingenuity has devised to inflict the maximum pain on a condemned man. The really ingenious little invention to keep the victim alive was the step to which his feet were nailed. As long as that was there, the prisoner was able to lever himself up, to get a shallow breath of air into the bits of his lungs that had not filled with fluid. When the legs were broken, they could no longer support themselves, their lungs filled with fluid, and they drowned. When the soldiers came to break the legs of Jesus, they found he had already died. To make sure, they thrust a spear into his heart, and immediately what blood was left in him flowed out, as did the water which he collected in his lungs. In this final draining of his lifeblood, the outflow of water, he has given absolutely everything. It was impossible for him to give more. But water is a sign of life, in fact essential for life. So in that last act of cruelty, we see the symbolism of baptism, the water of life flowing from the side of the dead Jesus, only to give life to us. St. Paul tells us that when we are baptized, we go down into the tomb of Jesus, only to rise with him to eternal life. This is the eve of the Sabbath, so there is need for great haste. We see the awful crown of thorns has been removed. St. John and Nicodemus gently hold the lifeless body of Jesus away from Mary's embrace and wrap it in a shroud. One of the women clearly wants to wash his body, but there's no time. They're all Jews, and they know that under Mosaic law, they must obey the commandment to keep the Sabbath day holy. No work can be done. A proper funeral, Jesus has not left the mandate to hang on the cross over the Sabbath, but is given what we used to call in the army a field burial. Later, when all is calm again, his friends will come, as does the Commonwealth War Graves Commission when war is over, to give him a dignified and proper burial. In the meantime, the grave is closed, the stone rolled into place, all go home, all is silent. Or is it? Let us now pray for our Holy Father's intentions. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now, and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now, and at the hour of our death. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now, and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. May the divine assistance remain always with us, and may the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.